heard a very interesting thing about India here at Davos today. It had a lot to do with talent, demographics and so on, but one economist really put it bluntly. Indians overperform in Davos and underperform when they're back in India. That subject in mind, I chatted with the top honchos of India Inc. and here is a slice of that debate.
Big problems in Europe. As Chancellor Merkel said, everybody thinks Europe has a big financial headache.
But you came to sell the India story all the same.
You have to have an audience that's ready to listen to the India story. When you have big problems like this, I think, you really don't have an audience. Okay. That's number one. Number two, I think, the India story in Davos this year is at a very low ebb.
Low ebb, yeah. Vineet Nair, would you agree with that? India has, got a reduced audience this time. Though I noticed Brazil, Mexico, even Indonesia are beginning to get a lot of attention.
No, I think Mr. Kalyani said the right thing. The focus is currently in Europe, on Europe. So mercifully, India is bit out of focus. And I use the word mercifully almost consciously, because otherwise some of the problems we are having will come to the fore.
And all of you would have to give explanations on behalf of the nation.
Well, I think there are good reasons, but we have not been asked so far on that.
Vindi Banga, you're certainly coming here with a little more bullish overtones. Do you think what your sort of contemporaries are saying is a tad too pessimistic?
Well, I think that, India is in a situation where the hype is always at extremes. It's either very, very positive or extremely negative. It's something to do with the Indian psyche. As individuals, we tend to be very emotional people, and I think our whole society tends to operate like that. The truth, as always, even then and today, lies in between. There's a reasonably steady level of base growth. I mean, India's huge success and huge differentiator in the world is that it is a domestic market story. So by definition, it is less impacted by all these challenges that the world is facing.
But then what has changed, Mr. Tanti? I mean, if truly India is probably seeing almost as much growth, but not 9% or not looking at 10%, but still outperforming the rest of the world, what has changed in the situation for India as such, the domestic market?
As you know, the domestic market itself is so large, is there. Unfortunately, certain our own issues are impacting our growth potentiality. Otherwise, we are not affected by the global environment, whether it is an economic environment or financial environment. It's not hurting India badly. The way the Eurozone is facing difficulty on the debt crisis situation, it's not impact on the Indian industries. And we are not able to regulate the proper environment. If we can really bring that initiatives, I think India can deliver the best performance.
Sanjay Nair, we always like to use the phrase policy paralysis, and let me leave everything to that to sort of encompass whatever problems India may have. But we can't just sort of wish things away, right? There is a growth story, there is a problem, we have to find a middle path.
Yeah, I agree. I think, I think everyone said the same thing, which is we're really underperforming to the potential that we can have. And I think fortunately, unfortunately, it's got nothing to do with cycles or with the global impact. It's all to do with our own homegrown issues. And policy paralysis may be just one of them. But, my larger worry is that these things get quite unstuck from here, because it's not that, you see things changing dramatically going ahead. And there's a great base case, as Vindi said, which I think is a great scenario. 7% is just not a bad scenario at all. But when you could be performing at 9.5 or 9,
right,
then it's, once again, a missed opportunity. And I just don't see how we get out of this unless there is real action again from the center and from the government.
Mr. Kalyani, we keep talking about this 9%. I mean, even at 7.5%, we're still the flavor from a growth point of view. Why should we not sort of continue to be as excited or as geared up to push the India story?
Most of us will have a record performance in this year that ends in March 2012.
Led by a domestic story.
Yeah. Led by a domestic story, this 7%, 8% growth, whatever else it is, everybody's going to have record performances. The problem is, what Vindi was talking about, 2 years ago we were trying to reach for the sky or the stars. And now, we are looking all the time down. We don't know how to trudge or how to get into a middle path. Keep growing at 7%,
but
take it to 8.
But did you think we were euphoric? I mean, was it unrealistic? Had we become too arrogant with that 9 to 10% possibility?
I wouldn't say arrogant. I think it's good to be optimistic. It's good to be, you know, good to aim for something higher. But at the same time, you've got to be realistic. So what's wrong with the 7% growth? I mean, to that extent, I agree with the government, you know. Nothing wrong with the 7% growth. But just one caveat. There are some fundamental issues in the economy which are going to have a much larger bearing on growth rate 5 to 10 years from now. And you don't fix that today. You know, I think 5 years from now, I mean, today we are at least amongst Indonesia and, you know, South Africa and Brazil.
You see, we're going to be left behind if we don't.
Yeah, it might be a different story.
Yeah, they keep saying the eye in the bricks is a very dynamic one. It could keep changing every now and then. Vindi Banga, a perspective there, which is this, that you're looking to invest as a private equity player constantly. Where does India lose out to Brazil, Indonesia and others? Where are we losing out? Because it's not like they have massively improved infrastructure. You know, that's something that we like to use as a reason.
I think India is still a very good story. And I think it can be even better. So let's start with that. At 7% growth, just compare it with the relative growths you see around the world. Even Brazil has much lower level of growth.
Right.
And of course, don't even worry about Europe and the US for the next couple of years. They're going to see probably, at best, a flat situation or maybe a little bit of positive growth. Now the question is, how can we make 7 go to 8 and 8 go to 8.5? And actually, you don't have to go to policy. Policy is the next step. The first thing is execution. At the recent Prime Minister's Council of Trade and Industry, one of the strong points made by several of us was there are perhaps 20 projects that need execution.
Yeah.
They're there, they've got permission issues, they've got some issue or the other. If we can concentrate on those 20 projects and get them executed in the next 2 to 3 years, we'll get 100 basis points, 1% of GDP growth.
But
that's
Vindi
today.
The point that Vindi Banga is making is something we all hear you all complain about every year. Obviously, that execution is not being put into place, and therefore India is beginning to lose that sheen over the last 12 months, even in international fora like these. I mean, in technology, for example, we have seen India lose out to Philippines and Brazil. I mean, you know.
Let me put it in a different perspective. We talk of 7%, we are fixated on 8%, we want to go to 9%. But hey, remember, we are starting from a very low base. I mean, as the old saying goes, happiness is starting from a low base. So I think we should not let that in any fashion impact our basic long-term issues about which Sanjay talked about.
Mm-hmm.
Infrastructure, obviously everybody thinks about. But what worries me most is education.
Yeah.
The quality of education is plummeted. At the moment it's pathetic. And you see it in results coming out.
Yeah.
We were, in terms of quality of education, we were rated second lowest in the world. If you think, why do you think the technology industry has moved up at the pace it has?
And moved out as well?
I don't buy that quite yet. It's moved up because it didn't require any infrastructure support. It didn't require ports, it didn't require roads, it didn't require clearances, all the ones which the real industry faces.